नमस्कार. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू नो समथिंग अबाउट द दाशरथ्नि वॉर एंड एपोकल वॉर. टुडे इज द ओकेजन ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस डे ऑफ इंडिया. इफ वी रीड द फर्स्ट आर्टिकल ऑफ इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, वी रीड इंडिया, दैट इज भारत. सो अ क्वेश्चन अराइजेस, व्हाट डज भारत मीन? भारत समथिंग दैट बिलोंग्स टू भरत. Where does this name come from? If we try and find out the answers to this question, usually the answers given are found in the Purana texts. Here, I have presented two stanzas from Vishnu Purana. The first one says, Uttaram yat samudrasya himadreshaiva dakshinam varsham tad bharatan nama bharati yatra santatihi. So it means, that country which is towards the north of the ocean and the south of the Himalaya Parvata is the country named Bharata, and the people living there are Bharati. The second verse says, Tatascha Bharatam Varsham Etal Lokeshu Giyate Bharataya Yatah Pitra Dattam Pratishthita Vanam. So this is the country named Bharata which is praised in the entire world, and it was given to Bharata by his father when he left for the forest life. In this regard, it is also said that this nomenclature has come from Bharata, son of Dushyanta and Shakuntala. So these are various answers which are popularly known. But if we visit even older Sanskrit texts, then we find the oldest reference to the name Bharatas, a family called Bharata, which is found in the oldest Vedic text named Rigveda. This text consists of approximately 1000 suktas or hymns addressed to various gods. In addition to the prayers to the gods, it introduces us to the ancient history of India. And we come across multiple names of people and places belonging to this ancient era. Bharatas are cited as an eminent ruling family in the Rigveda and the other Vedic texts. So we realize that they must be followers of the Vedic lifestyle when we go through these Vedic paragraphs. In this very text named the Rigveda, we learn that a king named Sudas belonged to the Bharata clan, and he was the winner of a war popularly known as Dasharadnya War. On the basis of the textual evidence from the Rigveda, Dasharadnya War appears as the first big war documented in the history of India and maybe the history of the world. Usually, the wars are fought for various reasons and with multiple intentions. They are considered a tool of destruction for the humankind, according to those who are not involved in the wars. A famous Sanskrit Subhashita A verse goes like this: Durasthaha parvataha ramyaha veshaha cha mukhamandane yuddhasya tu katha ramya trini ramyani durataha. So the mountains, when at a distance, the prostitutes with their faces made up, and the stories related to the wars are ramya, attractive, but from a distance. So being far away from this epochal war belonging to the prehistoric times, today let us travel through the pages, or rather the suktas or hymns of the Rigveda, and try to know about the Dasharadnya War. In this regard, first of all, let us see what does the word Dasharadnya mean. The word Dasharadnya shows something related to 10 kings or chieftains. So the word Dasharadnya means that the war must have took place among approximately 10 kings. I have purposefully said that this war happened among approximately 10 kings. While reading the ancient literature like the Vedas, we understand that in such cases, the numbers like 10 or 100, Dasha or Shata were used to show a large quantity. Thus, this war could be considered as a conflict between a big group of kingdoms, and not exactly number 10. While looking for the details of this episode, we need to look for both King Sudas, who was the winner of this war, and of course the war itself. So if we read the hymns of Rigveda, we come to know that one hymn from the third mandala, number 53, informs us about King Sudas, and three hymns from the seventh mandala, that is number 18, 53 and 83, describe about the war. Third mandala belongs to Seer Vishwamitra, that talks about King Sudas, and seventh mandala belongs to Seer Vasishtha, which prominently talks about the war, the Dasharadnya war. So we can think that these two seers, Vasishtha and Vishwamitra, might have some association with King Sudas. Now I'm going to describe about this war, keeping these four hymns in front of me. In the third mandala, we find Sudas's name when we get the description of the performance of Ashwamedha rite under the spiritual advice of Vishwamitra. Then we go to seventh mandala and we find the actual war descriptions. Now, before going to the details of these mandalas, I would like to take an account of the names of people who are involved in this war, other than King Sudas. So, we have King Sudas. His family name is Paijavana. King Sudas Paijavana. His Bharata family, and there was another family named Trutsu with Seer Vasishtha on one side of the war. The opposite party consists of Dasha Rajanaha, or the 10 kings, and the names we find are Puru, Yadu, Turvasha, Anu, Druyu, Alina, Paktha, Bhalanas, Alina, Vishanin, Shiva, Vaikarna, Matsya, Shimyu, Bheda, Aja, Shigru, Yakshu, and some more. Here you will see a chart mentioning these names. Here we realize that the names mentioned in the opponent party are certainly more than 10. And so the number 10 represented in the title Dasharadnya war is nothing but a great number. In this regard, some scholars opine that even Seer Vishwamitra was a part of this opposite confederate. However, none of the above said hymns mention that Vishwamitra was a spiritual leader or advisor or consultant, if we use the modern jargon, of the confederates against King Sudas. These hymns also praise some gods such as Indra, Varuna and Maruts. But let us discuss about these deities a little later. Now let us come to the actual account of the war. So, we had Sudas, King Sudas Paijavana, with his followers, the family named Bharatas, and the other family called Trutsus. They were once attacked by the combined and vast armies of the 10 kings. The Dasharadnya army cornered King Sudas and his army on the bank of the high-flowing river Parushni. Seeing the futility of resistance, Sudas escaped to the other bank of the river with his army. This happened due to the blessings of God Indra at the behest of Seer Vasishtha. This is told to us by the hymns of the Rigveda. Some of the 10 allies tried to pursue Sudas by crossing the river after him, but they were drowned in the river because of the onrushing flood sent down by Indra. Some of them tried to make the river shallow by digging channels in different directions and thus dividing the main stream. This is a very interesting reference. But they miserably failed in this venture and faced a severe disaster. What happened? In the river, some of these were washed by the forceful current of the river, and those who succeeded to reach the other bank of the river were killed by Sudas and his army. Some of them tried to flee and left their valuable possessions to the winners. The hymns also tell us that Sudas finished two Vaikarnas on the bank of river Parushni. He also destroyed a king called Bheda, but at the bank of river Yamuna. There were some other kings named Ajas, Shigrus and Yakshus. They had a different fate. They came and offered a tribute to Sudas. So probably they did the compromise. After taking this account, a brief account of the war, we must know the interpretations of this war by some scholars. Because when we study the prehistoric texts like the Vedas, the rules of present day life can't be applicable. So we need to know about the various interpretations of this war by various scholars if we really want to know the Dashrathni war. If we search the topic of Dashrathni war, it's studied by some modern scholars. Now we shall proceed to some of these important interpretations. First of all, Professor R.N. Dandekar, who was known as a great Indologist and basically specialized in the Vedic studies, who was very much related to this Bhandarkar Institute, has studied this topic. He has opined that Puru, Anu, Druyu, Turvasha and Yadu, which we have already seen in the list of the opponents of Sudas. So these were the five clans, and after these five clans, the concept of Panchajanaha, five people or five communities, which is found prominently in the Rigveda, is found. Side by side, in and round about the region, there were a few clans, but they followed non-Vedic lifestyle. So the Vedic era has witnessed both Vedic and non-Vedic communities living in the same region. Now there was a tribe of the Bharatas, and presumably they were few in number. Dandekar says that Sudas was the leader of the Bharatas and was a very ambitious man. He aimed at bringing the early Vedic prominent clans, that is Panchajanaha, and the non-Vedic principalities under his own control, and thereby establish the sovereignty of the Bharatas throughout the Saptasindhu. Sudas appears to have been as much a valiant warrior as a wise statesman for Dandekar. Sudas was convinced that in order to achieve his goal, diplomacy and military strategy would both be equally necessary. Dandekar further says that because Sudas had impeached Vishwamitra from the post of chief priest, Vishwamitra was not a man to take such things lying down. Embittered by the supercilious treatment meted out to him, which we find in the 53rd hymn of the Rigveda, 3rd mandala, he went over to the Panchajanaha. Vishwamitra woke them up to the danger of the impending invasion by the Bharatas and eventually maneuvered them into forming a kind of loose military confederation for the purpose of arresting the Bharata onslaught. He also hoped thereby to avenge the indignity which he had been made to suffer. Dandekar also says that the war consisted of many battles and skirmishes, but the decisive battle seems to have been fought on the bank of river Parushni. Then there is another scholar, Professor H.D. Velandkar. He highlights some other points related to this war. He clearly remarks that, I quote, "We do not get here any important information about the actual fight between the two parties, but only the frustration of the attempts of the powerful enemy to overpower Sudas and his Bharatas," I unquote. Velankar has further added that the Dasharanya war was a result of the Ashwamedha sacrifice. The chiefs and kings who were defeated in the course of the triumphant march of the sacrificial horse, they saw an opportunity of winning back their freedom and wielded war against Sudas. Velankar has pointed this out again from the 3rd mandala, which we have already seen. He interprets the names of Kavasha and Bhrugus doing priestly duties for the allies, the names Kavasha and Bhrugus, which occur in the list of the opponents of Sudas. Now let us come to another opinion by a scholar named Professor Michael Witzel, who proposes that the eminence of the Bharatas was established by Sudhas. However, their victory was not immediate because other tribes began to unite against them, either due to conspiracies of the ousted Vishwamitra or simply because of intra-tribal resentment. We see that Witzel repeats Dandekar's idea of Vishwamitra forged an alliance against Sudhas as an act of revenge. But Witzel also proposes some more points, and these points are the exact place of the battle, which was at the west of Kurukshetra, and the elated status of the Bharatas after this momentous war, or rather the elated status of the Bharatas after the victory of this momentous war. So here I would like to quote Professor Witzel. Then came the battle of 10 kings on the Parushni, modern Ravi in Pakistan, near Manusha, a location in the back or west of Kurukshetra, which the Bharatas won by breaking a natural dike on the river. Their eventual arrival on the Yamuna and the defeat of the local chief Bheda are finally chronicled in 7-18-19. The entire book 7 is thus a snapshot of history. The incursion of the Bharata into the Punjab from across the Sindhu and their battle with the five peoples and the Puru. It celebrates the victory of Sudhas in the battle of the 10 kings, which once and for all established Bharata supremacy in the Punjab and set the stage for the formation of the first South Asian state under the Kuru tribe. I unquote. Other than the two previous theories, Witzel has also proposed that the Bhrugus mentioned in stanza 7.18.6 are nothing else but Vishwamitra. So, one of the enemies of Sudhas was none other than Vishwamitra. Now, after summarizing some important interpretations of the Dasharadnya War, let us understand some stanzas from the Rigveda which are related to Sudhas and the Dasharadnya War. So, here is a line from the 11th mantra of the 53rd hymn of the third mandal of Rigveda. It says, Upapreta kushikaha chetayadvam ashvam raye pramunchata sudasaha. So, the translation of this line is, come forth Kushikas, make yourself known, release the horse of Sudhas to gain wealth. So, we here observe that the Kushikas, that is Vishwamitras, was the priest of King Sudhas at the occasion of the Ashwamedha performed by Sudhas. And so, certainly Vishwamitra was associated with Sudhas prior to the Dasharadnya War. Now let us turn to some stanzas from the three hymns of the seventh mandala. We shall get some actual textual evidences about the Dasharadnya War. This one from 7th 83 shows us the initial helpless condition of Sudhas. Dasharadnye pariyattaya vishvataha Sudhasa indra varunava shikshatam. It can be translated as this. You gave help to Sudhas, who was surrounded on all sides in the Dasharadnya War, O Indra and Varuna. In the 53rd hymn of the 7th mandala, there are some stanzas which provide us the names of almost all chieftains and others who fought in the war. Some stanzas also throw light on the final condition of some of the enemies of Sudhas. So, for example, Apakthaso Bhalanaso Bhananta Alinaso Vishaninaha Shivasaha. The Pakthas, the Bhalanasas, the Alinas, the Vishanins and the Shivas did loudly sing. This is what the line tells us. So, here we find the names Pakthas, Bhalanasas, the Alinas, the Vishanins and the Shivas from the Confederate. There is another stanza from the seventh mandala. Again, it says, Avat Indram Yamuna Trutsavascha Pratra Vedam Sarvatata Mrushayat Ajasascha Shigravo Yakshavascha Balim Shirshani Jabruhu Ashvyani. The Yamuna and the Trutsus pleased Indra. Here did he plunder Bheda completely. The Ajas, the Shigrus and the Yakshus brought him their tribute, namely the heads of the horses. In this stanza, we realize that a king named Bheda was killed, but the Ajas, the Shigrus and the Yakshus came ahead with gifts and probably they preferred to make a compromise. Now we shall see some real action happened during the war. So here is a stanza from 7th mandala, 18th hymn, number 11. It says, Ekanchayo vyushatincha shravasya vaikarnayoho janan raja nyastaha dasmona shadman nishishati barhihi shuraha sargam akrunot indra esham. It means, the king Sudas cut up his foes like a skillful priest who cuts down the grass for preparing a seat. When he overthrew the 20 and 1 tribes of the 2 Vaikarnas with a desire for fame, brave Indra arranged for their quick dispatch. Then there is another stanza which says, Indrena ete trutsavo vevishana apona srushta adhavanta nichihi durmitrasah prakalavin mimana jahuhu vishwani bhojana sudase. These trutsus, executing their task through the backing of Indra, swooped down upon the enemy like the waters moving downwards on being released by Indra after killing Rudra. The enemies, who had bad friends, abandoned all their possessions to Sudas, even though they were careful measurers, knowing even the smallest fraction of things which they gave to others. Till now, we haven't seen the name of this war, that is Dasharadnya, in the evidences. In the next two stanzas, from 7th mandala, 33rd hymn, we find the actual name Dasharadnya. The third stanza from this hymn says, Eva itnu kandasharadne sudasam pravat indro brahmanavo vasishthaha. Thus indeed did Indra save Sudas in the Dasharadnya war, owing to your hymn, O Vasishthas. Then the next stanza reads, Udyamiva trushnajo nathitaso adidhayuhu dasharadne vrutasah vasishthasya stuvata indro ashrot urum trutsubhyo akrunot ulokam. Being surrounded and distressed in the Dasharadnya war, they looked up to Indra with prayers as thirsty men looking up to the heaven for rain. Indra heard while Vasishtha was praising him and gave ample freedom to the Trutsus. So, after understanding these mantras, we realize that Vasishtha had excellent knowledge of the Vedic mantras. He successfully supported Sudas and Trutsus in the Dasharadnya war by chanting his efficacious prayers to God Indra. Now, coming to the third and last hymn in this series of the Dasharadnya war, and that hymn is number 83. We here find the requests made to the deities Indra and Varuna to save Sudas and his partners. Indra Varuna Vadhana Bhihi Apratibhedam Vanvanta Prasudasam Avatam Brahmani Esham Shrutam Havimani Satya Trutsunam Abhavat Purohitihi. It can be translated as, you have protected Sudas, O Indra and Varuna, subjugating Bheda with your deadly weapons in an inimitable manner. You heard the hymns of these Trutsus when they called for help. The priestly service of the Trutsus became effective. Thus, the two deities must have backed Sudas in his warfare and the Trutsus in their spiritual endeavor, which in turn supported Sudas. So, here is the time for comparison. If we compare the interpretations by the modern scholars and the actual wording of the Rigvedic hymns, we may say that the related Rigvedic hymns do not offer us a precise picture of this war. So, naturally, it allows an array of theories. It is absolutely clear that Sudhas and the Bharatas were the winners of the Dasharatha war. But we cannot be certain about what must have happened with each of the opponents. We cannot also know the exact reason behind the war. As we have already seen, scholars have emphasized that removal of Vishwamitra and his urge for a revenge might be the motive behind it. In this regard, it is true that Vishwamitra did not continue as the royal priest of Sudhas, and it is humane to feel like taking a revenge. But we do not find Vishwamitra's name clearly mentioned anywhere in the description of the Dasharatha war. We also do not find any other concrete evidence in the Vedic texts which may strengthen either this action of revenge or the emotion of revenge of Vishwamitra. So, it is difficult to accept this particular theory and consider it further as basis of the enmity between Vasishtha and Vishwamitra, which we find in the post-Vedic era. So, with this comparison, let us understand some more aspects of the Dasharatha war. Some historical and geographical details are found in the description of Dasharatha war. We come across a multitude of names of various communities, places, rivers or mountains, etc. For a long time, scholars of Indology and the Vedas are engaged in identification of such places or communities with those who are found in the history or even those who have retained the names till present day. The study of the Dasharatha war is not an exception. Some theories are proposed by scholars to decipher the varied names of the clans gathered to oppose Sudhas. For example, Anus and other four families. We have seen that these were the five eminent clans in the early Vedic references, the Panchajanaha. Matsyas. When we see the name Matsya, some think that there is a pun on the word Matsya. Matsya means a fish. So, it is used as a simile for fighting families, hungry fish, or it is a brave dynasty who is mentioned also in the later literature like Mahabharata, etc. Vaikarnas. If we try and find out the name Vaikarnas, St. Petersburg Dictionary has placed this name in Kashmir. Shivas. The word Shiva, according to Dr. Dandekar, is usually identified with the Siboi of Alexander's annal writers. Vishanin. This word literally means those who possess horns. So, this community must be the community which used to wear headgears with horns on it. Against all this discussion or theories, certain things are identified and accepted by now. So, the first one. The family named Paktha. Their territory is identified with the modern Pakhtunistan on the northwest border of Pakistan. Number two, the Vedic river Parushni is the modern river Ravi, now in Pakistan. And the third, Yamuna, the name of which is always known as Yamuna. Now this data has helped people, scholars and even us to determine the geographical area where the Dasharatha war was fought. Here we have presented two maps of the Vedic India. In the first one, we see the proposed regions of the participants in the war, the proposed kingdoms of the various clans. And the second one shows us the location of Parushni and Yamuna. While reading and talking about the Dasharatha war, we find some special features in this description. We have already seen that the Vedic mantras highlight the contribution of the Vedic gods such as Indra and Varuna to the Dasharatha war. Some other stanzas depict that it was Indra who made it possible to win the enemies. Similarly, spiritual advisors like Vasishtha also contributed heavily in the success of Sudhas. I have already said that while reading the ancient texts like the Vedas, we can't apply the modern rules every time. And therefore, when we go through the Vedic texts, we understand that the Vedic Indians had their own set of beliefs, like any other ancient or modern community. The Vedic Indians believed in God Indra as a warrior god. And if one praises him and requests him, then he will come to one's aid. So in the Vedic texts, whenever we come across references of fights between humans, we also come across appeals to Indra for success in the war. The same has been seen in the Dasharanya war. In this case, a question might arise, what if both the parties appeal to Indra? And here comes the role of spiritual advisors or the priests. That party usually won who had a superior priest. That was the belief of the Vedic people. We have seen that Sudas could win due to the chanting of powerful mantras by Vasishtha. Hence, we can say that Vasishtha's spiritual knowledge was more effective and he also applied it effectively compared to the spiritual leaders of the opponents. If we review all wars documented in the history, their forms changed as the humankind changed. The initial weapons like arrows, spears, and swords were replaced by guns and bombs. Horses, elephants, and chariots were replaced by war tanks and bombing choppers. And now, for some decades, we are introduced to some new avatars of the war, such as chemical or biological wars. If we apply the same logic to the Dasharanya war, we may say that the divine intervention by Indra or Varuna and spiritual guidance by Vasishtha or anyone else was a part and parcel of the Vedic life and so the Vedic warfare. Therefore, this is how are the intricacies of the epochal war from the Rigveda. I hope that it will make the viewers of this video to go deeper in the analytical and textual study of the Vedas and other Sanskrit literature to know more and more about the ancient history of India in particular and humankind in general. Thank you. I thank the authorities of Mandarkar Institute for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much.